And that determines our life from then on. Because we have a choice from then on. We either insist on living our own life and interacting in ways with the Christian religion, going to church, singing hymns, getting our doctrines straight, learning Sunday school and all the rest. We do that, and that's necessary and that's good, but it isn't of the essence. The essence is that we live before God in such a way that Christ is formed in us. And that scripture via Galatians 4:19. So there's our decision. The greatest decision that any believer ever makes is to forsake his own life and to tend to that seed. Now, how do we tend to the seed? We tend to the seed by prayer, talking to the Lord. You know, you talk to the Lord. I talk to the Lord all day long, and I don't expect you starting off like that, but get in the habit of talking to Christ. Let's get in there and talk to him. When you get up in the morning, talk to him. How are you doing, Lord? This is great. Help me today. I need wisdom. I think I'm going to flunk my English test. Well, I need help there, Lord. I've been lazy and foolish, and now I need help with that. Help me to be more whatever I'm supposed to be. And you keep this up all the time. Just talking to the Lord. Just talking to the Lord about everything. Anything you can think of. Talk to the Lord about it. That's one way. And then there should be, as I said, times that you set aside once a day at least in which you spend time in prayer and listening for what God has to say. He'll talk to you. One way or another, he will talk to you. May not be in a voice, but he will make his will known to you. And read your Bible. God will speak to you through the Bible. God will make his will known to you in different ways, sometimes through people, through unsaved people, sometimes through saved people, sometimes through incidents that happen in your life. All of a sudden you realize God is saying something to me. Be obedient. There is no lasting righteousness apart from obedience to God. And I don't mean once in a while, I mean all the time. Well, if you make up your mind to be obedient to God all the time, you see what that does to your orientation to life. You tell me, what does it do to your orientation to life? If you decide to obey God in every matter, when he makes his will known, you'll do it regardless of what it is. What does that say about your orientation to life as a person? How does it change it? You see what you're doing? You're denying yourself. As he said, deny yourself, take up your cross. So you're denying yourself. It's not what I want, what God wants. What do you want today, Lord? Listen, there is no Christian life other than that. The rest of it is just church. And in the dreadful things that are on the horizon for America, it isn't going to last. Now, I'll probably be dead and gone by the time God begins to exercise his wrath on America. And he's going to do that, too, because of the abortion. And you may be here. Remember what I said. You're going to see a lot of supposedly Christian people who are compromising all along the way, don't know what they're doing. The only thing that will stand is absolute obedience to God. You would think from the prevailing church life and teaching that it's kind of important to obey God once in a while, but nobody expects someone to obey God all the time. That's the lie. That's the lie in our culture. God created us. How many agree with that? Does he have a right that we should obey him in everything he says or not? Nothing. Being our creator, does he have a right? Does he have the right to control, to tell us that we must obey everything he says or not. What do you think? He has that right. Christ died and shed his blood to redeem us so that we would not be destroyed, so that we would have eternal life. Does he have a right to expect total obedience from us or not? Well, now think about that, because your answer to that will determine your life. You'll either go on like an ordinary Christian in America, which is casual, you know, nothing. It's nothing at all. They're in delusion. The whole group is in delusion. I don't care what they do. The only thing that matters is absolute obedience to God. I mean, without any equivocation. Well, then it may sound like that isn't possible. To the contrary. It's entirely possible, because God does not give us impossible things to do. He does not make impossible demands upon us. His demands are very reasonable and moderate, and as Judge pointed out to us, we don't think because God makes them right or whatever, they are right, and that's why God does them, and they bring health, and they bring joy, and they bring peace, and they bring all the things that we want. Satan, in the meanwhile, has got a demon on his shoulder saying, well, you can't serve God like that, you'll have a miserable life, and God will whip you if you do wrong, and blah, blah, blah. That's Satan's business that he started with Eve. You can't trust God. He told you not to eat of the tree of life, because he knows if you do, you'll be wise like God. See, in other words, God, what God was telling you to do was really not in your best interest. That Satan will tell you that all the time. And what you have to do is just shuck this off. Just shuck it off. And say, now, I'm a rational person, an intelligent person, and if God made me and Christ died for me, then I have to obey them. And if I don't, where am I in the world? I mean, what is the meaning of my life if I don't obey my Creator? It's just as simple as that. But you won't find that out spelled out in churches. You will not find it. The churches, in many cases, are good, solid, sincere people of integrity, but far too often they're businesses. Get the most people in and compromise the word. They don't even know the word themselves. They weren't taught it in seminary. What am I railing against? I don't want to rail against anyone. I know where I'm going with this. Probably won't ever get there. So she's clothed with a righteousness, not merit, with the Son is righteousness, stands for righteousness, not merely by identification, but because she has been filled with the nature of Christ. And you see that up there on Galatians 4:19. My little children, of whom I travail until Christ is formed in you. Why was he saying that? Because he had been through Galatia. They had received the message of the gospel. And then Jewish teachers had come by and said, you've got to be circumcised and keep the law. And the reason that they were persuaded was because they had believe the gospel, but Christ had not been formed in them. Therefore, they were susceptible to misunderstanding. He said, if you'll ever get Christ formed in you, you won't fall into these traps. You see that? But I want you to notice the expression, until Christ is formed in you. Look at that. How many can see that that is not identification? How many can see it's not imputed righteousness? It's not righteousness assigned to you. It's something altogether different. Can you see that? How many can see that? If you can't see that, you want to understand what I'm talking about. Having Christ formed in you is not the same as having his righteousness assigned to you. It's a whole different ball game. And talk about being responsible for your actions. This is a recreation of what you are.